I was born in the Soviet Union. When you're growing up, there's a few bands that kind of, I mean, they're probably forbidden still, but they seep in, and you get like bootlegged, and they somehow take over the culture of the young folks, such as myself. So on the metal side, it was Metallica and Iron Maiden. And on the, I don't know what you call them, but Beastie Boys, I remember hearing Fight For Your Right. And it was just like, for some reason that stuck, as it did for a lot of people in Russia. It's like, wow, America is when you get to say fuck you to the man, the rebellion, the freedom. I probably heard it a few years after it was released, because it kind of, it dissipates to the culture. You get the bootleg. It's hard to get your hands on. But I just remember, I wanted to kind of bring that up because it was such a personally important song to me. And yet probably you didn't even think of that. You probably thought of it as its role in the culture here in the United States, like in terms of musically. But it's just,
I was, 21 years old, and we just
well, you made, were that kid too, yeah, right?
We were just making fun songs for our friends. There was no expectation.
So that's just a fun song.
Yeah, no one thought, we never imagined anybody would like any of it.
One of the greatest albums ever.
Yeah.
I have to. I love this so much. I just remember. This is America. I didn't even understand the lyrics, to be honest. And the lyrics are ridiculous.
Ridiculous.
So hearing that and hearing Metallica, Master Puppets, I was like, I knew I'm going to have to end up in America one day. Yeah. I mean, maybe now that I'm more mature, or maybe a little bit more mature, I realize like that was kind of the longing for freedom. It felt like, at least at the time, if this is allowed, then anything is allowed.
Yeah.
And I think the rebellion of it, I guess it's also fun. I just loved it. Is there, if you look back to that, because you were that person, not just the producer. It feels like,
well, yes and no. Like it was, even to us then, it was still like satirical. You know, absolutely.
But isn't like music in part, like you're dancing on the line, it's part satirical, part serious, in the sense, like you're losing yourself in the satire. Like when you ever, anytime you go over the top, isn't that part of the, or is it explicitly satirical? You're making fun. I mean, girls, there's a lot of ridiculous songs in that album.
I don't know. I just think it was definitely to make each other laugh. Like we were trying to make each other laugh. Yeah. We weren't trying to make a point. We were trying to make each other laugh.
But that person, how's that person different than the person today in you? The person that produced that
record. I wouldn't say so different. It's like, it really is that I like things that make me laugh. You know, I like ridiculous things.
This is the same person still.
I think so.
Is it strange, just how many incredible...
I mean, I don't think I would make that today, but I understand why we made it when we did. It's in the vocabulary of ridiculous that would make sense to do, you know, for the right artist today could make something ridiculous and gives you that feeling.
I mean, there's just a sense when you make so many different albums and you look back at that creation, it can feel like a different person created that. But you're making it seem like if you travel back in time or maybe do a memory replay, you'd be able to hang out with the with a teenage in the 20s, Rick Rubin.
I think he's just fine. I don't think I was so different, honestly.
That's hilarious.
It's funny. I ran into someone recently in Costa Rica who I hadn't seen in a long time and who I knew from the New York days when those days. And we spent a couple of hours talking and she said, "You're exactly the same person that you were then." So I have a short, you know, a recent confirmation that that's the case.
That's beautiful.